All right, well, shit, man. We go ahead. We got it live right now. I forgot to change the promo, though, so fuck it. Go on and get us into it, Chris, so we can figure out what the hell we just watched.
Well, let's get in some bloody theme music, can we?
With the accent for that ass.
Home video hustle. Hey yo, Bryn watching movies with Chris and Cam and talking shit about the movies with the fam. Special guest Patreon picks and the best commentary on movies, cause we keeping it fresh, cause it's the
hustle, motherfucking hustle. What's going on, everybody? I'm Brent.
Chris.
And this is the home video hustle we do, Chris.
H-U-S-T-L-E, hustle.
Damn right. So, we're off the bat. I don't know what the fuck we watched this week, y'all. I ain't even gonna mess around with y'all. Welcome to Whoop Whoop is the episode this week, and this is episode 346. Patreon pick number 53 from the homie Awful Hero. Is he a hero or was this plane awful? Keep listening to find out, folks. Chris, had you ever heard of this shit before?
No.
Okay,
so I hadn't heard it all.
You know who had heard of it is the homie Mario from Soup Complex. Went up to his, while he was working at the bar yesterday, went up there and got a drink and shit with Anita. Then we dropped the name of the movie. He's like, oh, I know that movie. Used to play on HBO all the time. So there is one person that has heard of this movie, Chris. Just not me. But
probably during HBO times when there's only like a handful of movies playing every day.
The good HBO times. Now, the thing is, that the way it is now, they only play the same movies. But back in the day, I used to love HBO because they would just play random shit. Like, I saw so many movies because the nanny house had HBO. Now, like last time I had HBO, well, I mean, they got HBO Max and all that. Now, so nobody really gives a fuck about HBO anymore. But
HBO is streaming now.
Yeah, everything is streaming now. But before that, I would remember seeing like the same, like you said, 10, 15 movies every fucking day. And it's always like the big blockbuster studio movies. Never no weird shit like this. It was always like the Fast and the Furious or, I don't know, a Star Wars. I don't know, just something like that. It was never Welcome to Whoop Whoop. I miss those
days. Right.
It's like the same thing I always say with the Sci-Fi Channel. I remember I used to watch the Sci-Fi Channel, see all the anime shit and all the weird stuff and Mystery Science Theater. Now you turn on Sci-Fi Channel, you're watching Fast and Furious.
That's true.
Or Harry Potter.
You're watching Fast and Furious or a Sharknado sequel randomly.
I'd rather that. Like, I miss those days. Even I don't even know if Sci-Fi does their own little original movies like that, like they used to. I miss those.
It seems like they just spammed their original catalog.
I guess they look at, fuck it, we made enough of this shit. Y'all gonna like it.
Right.
But did we like Welcome to Whoop? Chris, this came out in 1997, which is weird because I was thinking this is like, this seemed like a 1992 movie or something. Like, it don't feel like an almost 2000 movie.
It doesn't.
Let me double check. I gotta make sure because I'm like, man, it ain't no way.
I thought it said 98.
That's even worse. No, it's not. Okay, it's 97. It feels like an early 90s movie to me, but came out in 97. I saw multiple things. There were some websites that said it was an hour and 46 minutes. Some said it's an hour and 37. What I watched was an hour and 37. Chris, what about you?
Yeah, hour 37.
So I don't know where that 40 shit came from. But, oh, and as you guys noticed, it's just me and Chris. Anita was like, I'm not watching that shit.
She said, I'm bowing out.
But nah, she was out with her homegirl yesterday when we was watching the movie and all that. But Chris, you get to do this by yourself. Ultimate PJ scenario for you now. So how much you think this cost to make?
My gut says $2 and a ham sandwich like usual, but I think it's more than that.
It's definitely more than that.
Let's say $5 million.
$5 million.
Wrong!
More.
Jesus.
I was shocked too.
12.
Ooh.
Wrong!
Now you went over. It cost $10 million to make this movie. But now the fun part. How much you think this made at the theater? And apparently it did come out.
It came out in the theater. $7 million.
Wrong!
Lower.
Jesus, 1.5.
Wrong! Lower.
It made like $150,000?
Wrong! It made more than that.
So what, like 750,000?
Wrong!
And this is an exact number, folks. It made in the theater on a $10 million budget, $527,346.
That's not even worth the bomb, biggity bomb, biggity biggity bomb title. This is even worse.
Nobody went to go see that shit. Let me see. Let me look, see what the Wikipedia. Maybe it just had a limited release or some shit. Let me see. Box
office.
That's
a nuclear explosion.
Well, I mean, it doesn't say worldwide. Maybe it made more, but it says it grossed 400 and oh no, this is even worse. Never mind. Because I was gonna say, the thing I see says it grossed 489,725 in Australia. So I guess if that's 527,346 is the worldwide gross, then that's fucking terrible. Oh, you know, before I read the other, there's some other little things down there we're gonna say. But first, Chris, IMDb score is something 0.7 out of 10 with 2,075 votes. What you think it is?
I'm gonna say 6.7.
5.7. PJ did, but it's all right though. What about there is it both? We got critics and audience, so it did come out in theaters somewhere. Chris, what about the critics? What do you think they thought about this movie?
Is it rotten?
It's rotten as fuck.
Let me say 12%.
Wrong!
It's higher than that.
45?
Wrong!
37% from the critics. They did not like this shit. Now, the audience, though, Chris, this may shock you. What do you think the audience thought about this? You're going to be so mad if you don't guess this number.
69, give me one more time.
69% from the audience.
Hey.
So, Welcome to Whoop Whoop, again, was given to us by Awful Hero, but it was directed by Stephen Elliott.
Who's he?
I did look him up. I actually did recognize one of the movies that the homie made. I think it was a movie called Priscilla, Queen of the Desert. I had heard of that movie before, never seen it.
Mm-hmm.
But let me see. Crew, director. He directed such films as Priscilla, Queen of the Deserts, Rio, I Love You, Eye of the Beholder, Easy Virtue, The Best Men, Not the Best Man, Swinging Safari, Horizon, Frauds, which may be a fucking movie we got to watch one day because it's a fuck. Who is this? It's got my man's Hugo Weaving in it.
Mm.
And then right in the middle of the poster is an evil Phil Collins. And it's actually Phil Collins. He just looks evil.
I'm sorry.
So what? I'm just going to add that to the watch list because we may be coming back to that one day. And then Welcome to Woo Woo. And you know, the thing is, a lot of shit, Chris, I knew it wasn't going to be like on Letterboxd. I knew it wasn't going to be like the first movie on there. Because they always put them in order of like how many reviews they got or how much interaction they get. Priscilla, Queen of the Desert was number one because that's the movie everybody knows about. But out of all those movies I named, even the Phil Collins evil movie, Welcome to Whoop Whoop is like the bottom of all those movies. So it's the least interactive. One of the least interactive. The only other one that was lesser was that Horizon movie, but that was a short. It's only 55 minutes long. Mm. So of all the movies he made, this is the bottom, Chris. And I'm gonna fuck this name up. I don't know how you pronounce this dude's name, but it's starring Jonathan
Schaubach.
Is that how you say that shit?
S-C-H-A-E-C-H?
Sage?
S-C-H-E-A-C-H?
Yeah. Or it's A-E-C-H. Yeah. Shaich?
Shike?
Shike? That guy. Rod Taylor, Susie Porter.
Jerry O'Connor looking dude.
There you go. And 90s guy and D smart. Now, before we go on, Chris, I'm gonna just go ahead and read this Wikipedia stuff I saw right now because I'm gonna know I'm gonna forget if I don't do it now. It says his earlier film released, The Adventures of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, had become a Cannes hit in 1994. The uncompleted version of Welcome to Woot Woot was screened out of competition at the 1997 Cannes Film Festival, an experience he described as excruciating. So I'm taking it that means that they probably didn't like it very much and they let him know that. Australian film critic Michael Adams later included Welcome to Whoop Whoop on his list of the worst ever Australian films. But it has become a cult classic in the years following its release, notably loved by RuPaul. So this is one of RuPaul's favorite movies. Will it be one of ours? Chris, mm-hmm. please. How the fuck does Welcome to Whoop Whoop start? Fuck. Or is it Whoop Whoop or is it Whoop Whoop? I forgot. I thought I saw it.
It's Whoop Whoop.
Okay.
Because that's what their name of their town was.
I could have swore maybe it was the accents. I thought I heard somebody say, Welcome to Whoop Whoop. I was like, wait, what? But all right, Whoop Whoop is what we're going to go with, folks. So how does it start, Chris?
It starts in good old New York.
Yeah, that's right. I wasn't expecting that.
Apparently.
New York. I got 100 guns, 100 clips. Well, actually, I'm not going to finish that line because we're going to have this is going to be true this time. But
like, for real. Apparently, this dude named Teddy is out here trying to sell some birds.
He's slanging birds for real. Literally slanging birds, folks.
Slinging birds. Bird is the word.
Bar, 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 bar. Hey, did they ever call him Lionel at some point in this movie?
No, I don't know.
I'm going to tell you, Chris. I don't know why. But for like half of my notes, I wrote this motherfucker's name is Lionel. I don't know why.
It might have been how it started. I'm not sure.
I know he's like, just spoilers for what Chris about to tell you, but he's in disguise. And I was like, was that the name? But then I was like, no, because the first line, it says Teddy runs after birds. So I'm like, where the fuck did Lionel come from? I don't know where I got that from. But I'm sorry to cut you. All right.
Apparently he's trying to sell some birds. But then... The bird's a word. But then some dudes come out of nowhere. It's like, tried to stop him because he's selling on their turf.
Yeah, I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know if he was selling on their turf or he owed them money or I don't know what the fuck was going on here. They don't really go into it. This is going to be a quick scene. We're not going to care after about 5 minutes, but yeah, I don't know what the fuck was happening.
Right. So, and then I guess his girlfriend at the time was a stripper. She comes out bucking.
Yeah, she got the fucking heat on her because they got the homie hemmed up and she jumped out the back of the truck. Oh, because he was slinging literal birds. Was they like some kind of Australian cockatoo birds or something? He said.
Yeah.
And there's a couple, like, I don't know if there were a couple, there's two women there and they're buying the bird and he's like, oh, it's $1,000. And when them dudes jump out, they like, hey, well, thank you. We're going to go ahead and leave now. And he's like, hey, it's $1,000. They're like, bye. So they got them a free bird. That's what's up.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, while the two dudes over there harassing, she pulled out the burner and I didn't expect it, but she shot one dude in the foot, Harlem Nights style.
You shot him in the shoe. Why did you shoot him in the shoe?
At least she didn't do like training day. Like, oh, you shot me in the ass. But yeah, she shoots him in the foot and then he's on the ground talking shit. And I was shocked because she just says, oh, bow, shoots his ass again. I was like, oh, shit.
And he's just over there freaking out. Like, what the fuck are you doing? These guys know people. They're my friends. These guys, you know who these guys are? They're going to come after me.
And while he's harassing her about it, the black dude ends up handcuffing himself to her. And I laugh because I've thought this in other movies where they do the little, oh, I'm just going to handcuff you to me type thing. She just looks him up and down and is like, oh, word? Bow! Shoots him in the fucking chest and kills him too.
Jesus, freaking out. Like, what the fuck are you doing?
And so I did laugh because he's just like, I got to get the fuck out of here. All his birds are like loose from the truck and they're all flying away. And he starts running after her.
Somehow she I guess, knocked into the truck that loosened up all the cages and the birds all flew out.
Somehow all the cages just got open. I don't know how that happened either, folks. It's a comedy. Don't worry about it, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But he just starts running after her. She's like, hey, what are you doing? Because, you know, the cop sirens, the cops are on their way. And there's two bodies here and she got the murder weapon still in her hand. And he's like, hey, I got to go after my birds.
So yeah, basically, if I help you out right now, you're gonna keep asking me for help, and you're gonna keep owing me, and this is bad luck.
Exactly, he's gonna repeat that later, folks. Remember that line. And so she basically gets fucked. She's going to jail. You don't see it though, but you just assume that's what's happening, or maybe because he's chasing after the birds. And here's I guess your social commentary or whatever, folks. But people on the street see the birds flying by, and they're like, "Oh, look, birds!" And every single person on the street, man, women,
everybody
child,
in New York got a gun for everybody. No reason.
They all pull out straps and they all start shooting up at the birds. I admit I did laugh.
I laughed too. I'm like, what is this?
I guess that's everybody in America just got guns on them, Chris, which they're not wrong.
I mean, this is 98, so.
Was he Australian? Yeah. There was a guy. I saw there was a video going around. I don't remember if he was Australian or not, but. The guy was talking about like how much he was like, he came to America. He's like, yeah, I don't think I'll be going back there. And they're like, what you mean? He's like, you know, everybody just walking around with guns on them like it's normal and shit. Like the shit you see in like Western movies and all that. He's like, I'm good, bruh.
So it's he like, went to Texas.
I forget where he even went, man. But that's what I'm saying. That's the outside, you know, other countries view of it. Just a bunch of dumbasses shooting at everything with guns. And unfortunately, mm-hmm. they're not fucking wrong. But yeah, then you get into the opening titles of the movie. And I'm going to just go ahead and just throw this out there now. Here's a baby spoiler for you. Probably that's the best part of this whole movie is this opening sequence.
I mean, yeah.
Nothing ever gets as good as that part. Like, I laughed. Like, Anita, she was actually in the room at the time when I started watching it. And she was like, oh, I hear you laughing. And I don't know if you heard me laughing again much after that. Maybe once or twice we'll get into it. Because mm-hmm. I will say legitimately, I watched it this morning. And it is quickly leaving my mind.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to have to do this quick. Nah. But yeah, after the title, I guess he wasn't bullshitting. He said they were like Australian birds. They flew away. And he somehow got all the way to, what did it say? Northern Territory, Australia.
Yeah.
In the first.
Apparently he's driving around the Northern Outback.
He got like a little Scooby-Doo van, a little Volkswagen joint.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing he does is I thought he dodged it because he swerves his car like grindhouse style, but he actually did hit a kangaroo in the street. That's the first thing I thought about. Every time I see this in the movie, now I think of Grindhouse or Planet Terror specifically, I should say, where he was saying like, hey man, look, you see something in the street, you hit it full on. Because if you just swerved it, you're going to probably kill yourself.
Yeah, he kept saying some kind of phrase, but they just keep, Daddy-O keeps saying a certain phrase like, you should have ran it over, like wombo combo, something like that.
You know, I don't remember what the saying was, but all I could think of was my man Orumov, I can't pronounce that name ever, from GoldenEye. When he was trying to get away with Natalia in the back seat and they were driving through St. Petersburg, and he's like, use the bumper. That's what it's for. And he just
that's what the bumper's for.
He just immediately cut the people like flying off the front of the car. That is like legitimately one of my, that's why GoldenEye is my favorite movie, James Bond movie. I don't care. Fuck y'all. Like, Nanny would be in tears every time we watched that, and that scene happened because it just immediately, like, that was more comedy than a lot of stuff in this comedy movie. But we'll get to it, though. But yeah, he ends up, I guess it does come back in a way. I don't know. I was going to say because he ends up mercy killing it because it's sitting there and it's, like, twitching and shit. And he gets his guitar and just whacks it over the head and kills it.
It's going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you.
Yeah. And then it just, I thought it would come back, but I guess in the very end of the movie, maybe it does. I don't know, but fuck all that, because he had to pull over and go get some gas and wash his ass, and that's bars. And life-changing moment is about to happen to your boy, because while he out there washing his ass, a girl is right around the corner watching him. Chris, tell me about it.
Yeah, this girl's name is...
Angie.
Angie. She's just sitting there watching him, watching him wash his ass, and she's just like, hey... Like, hey, what's up? And
she says some Australian slang to him about his dick, I think. I don't remember what it was.
You pass me a towel? And he's just like, well, she's just like, that's gonna cost you extra.
Mm-hmm. And she's sitting there eating like a strawberry or cherry.
Cherry, right.
There you go. Some kind of bar, candy bar thing.
It's an old school candy bar that I've heard of before.
No, I didn't know that. I thought that was just some made-up shit for the movie.
It's like an old-school European candy bar.
Or some Australian shit. We must not have that here.
It's like UK shit.
Oh, okay. But, you know what? We're going to break the protocol a little bit and skip ahead a little bit, because I got a question. I was wondering about this. You just watched it. So, later on, when they get to Whoop Whoop, Badaddy-O, the leader there, says... Nobody is allowed to leave here. I don't let nobody leave. How the fuck is she here? Why? Is she just like, is it like Texas Chainsaw Massacre where they just in on it? Maybe they're using. Well, no, because then the dude with the whatever the fuck.
Well, that I mean, that's his daughter. She probably convinced him to go because she was out looking for her husband, I think.
She was just out searching. She was yeah. Okay. Because I was thinking that when he said, I'm like, wait, well, why the fuck was she not here? But I guess, that's how you pull people into the community, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I guess that makes sense. I was kind of annoyed. I'm like, wait, how the fuck? All right, I won't think about it too much then, Chris.
Mm-hmm. Don't think about it too much.
I wouldn't have thought about this next scene too much, but it comes back for a slight bit at the end. But he goes back to his car after they put the gas in, and some random dude just done jumped in the car like, hey, you know, my mans need a ride. And he's like, all right, well, anybody else need a ride? And then Angie jumps in the fucking car too. But this dude, he ends up dropping him off. He's telling him about Big Red. I guess it's some kind of legendary kangaroo.
Keep a watch out for Big Red.
Yeah, Chris is going to handle all the accents this week for you folks.
Don't know, Mike.
But he gets out of the car and he just says, hey, can I borrow $20? And he says this thing that Chris just said earlier about, what was it?
Could I borrow $20, Mike? He's just like, yo, I could give you $20 right now, but I won't. You want to know why? Because if I give you $20 right now, you're gonna owe me, and I'm probably never gonna see you again, and it's not gonna be a good idea. He's just like, I promise I'll pay you back. He's just like, fuck it.
Then Girlie's persistent. She's like, well, give him 10 or something. I don't know if he gives him 20. She said, give him something.
Mm-hmm.
May have been some more slang I didn't hear, but yeah, he hands him something. And dude's like, thanks, brother, and then he walks off. And then from this point forward, it's just Angie reeling your man's in. Expertly.
He's like, wrapping around her finger.
Exactly. Like Chris said, her whole plot, just to get it out the way now, she plots. And she want a husband, or preferably she wants some dick.
Yeah, she needs some dick in her life.
What you need?
Need some dick in your life.
Well, she about to get it. Because she's sitting up front and she's like asking a bunch of questions and she's like, you know, suggestively eating her little candy bar thing. And he's, of course, catching it from his side eye. And then she's like, what's up?
You don't got a wife or anything, do you?
Yeah, she's like, girlfriend? You married? And he's like, nah. And then she just pounces on homie. She starts rubbing the hand up like his pant leg and everything, saying different shit to him. And then just like I said, probably the better word for it, pounces him. Jumps literally on top of him, like clawing at him, ripping his clothes off, and they fuck. I didn't expect I didn't expect it to be as explicit as it was, for lack of a better term, because they naked and they fuck.
That was barely PG-13 though.
I didn't expect that though.
Or not barely PG R. I mean, it's barely R.
Well, I was say she got the titties out. They showed.
Yeah, that barely makes R most of the time. I think that's probably because that's probably the only thing that made it R. This probably would have been PG-13.
Well, he got the language too, I guess. Yeah, he don't show his dick, but he did have his bare ass out in that scene with the shower too.
Oh yeah.
And like I say, they show her getting her shit pushed in, bro, multiple times. But yeah, they was going crazy.
Yeah.
And they even
had to have been like a good entire day of them just doing nothing but fucking.
Exactly, because it was a montage. Couldn't think of the word. Sorry, PJ. I know it's PJ's thing. But it was a montage. We're just on fucking in the van, fucking outside.
Yeah, he got tired in the van. Was just like, I need a moment.
Yeah, because it's like it goes from, it shows him fuck the first time, then it shows him waking back up, and then she's like, don't you like me? Don't you want more? Can I have some more dick, sir? Basically. And he,
please, can I have some more?
A little piece of that dick, sir. And then he's like, okay. And he rolls over and they start fucking again. But then it goes into a montage where it shows him like on the beach or whatever, doing it in the car, doing it outside in the desert, doing it. But then I laugh because I wrote it down. Yeah, she's talking to him and she's like, well, don't you want to part my beef curtains again or something like that? Nah, fucking not.
Oh, the first round that made me laugh, the dude drove by in the truck. Like,
oh, what did he say?
He said, yeah, pork or sausage or something like that.
Yeah, I heard you say something about sausage. I couldn't understand with the accent. I ain't had no subtitles.
Yeah, poker with your pork sausage or something like that.
That shit was funny as hell.
I was dying.
And I did, like I said, her talking about parting her beef curtains. That was legit, like, other than the opening.
Oh, my Lord.
I ain't never heard that one. And like Chris said, at one point, he like, man, I need a break. Go to sleep, motherfucker. And then that's when you get the montage. They wake up. They're fucking again.
He needs a few energy drinks or something.
Man, that meant a monster. Before you give her the monster.
get him a Viagra or something. Shit.
There you go. Some Cialis for you out here in Australia. But after this chick calmed down and they finally able to have a conversation again, she's going on about, oh, you know, I've never had a boyfriend before and I'm a virgin. And he gets upset by that because he's like, why the fuck didn't you tell me that shit? And then from there, she just was like, please promise you won't dump me. I've never seen the sea. She's like, if you're going to dump me, can you just do it after we go to the sea?
He's just like, fuck it. I'm not going to dump you. Yeah, I promise. I won't lie.
Yeah, as you can tell, feelings are actually being formed. So he's like, I'm not going to dump you. And then I was laughing because the way she talked about the sea, I was just expecting a whole different movie at this point, honestly, too.
Yeah, dang.
I was thinking some Natural Born Killers type shit where it's just going to be like a road trip thing. But when she made the comment about, oh, I cannot, don't dump me till we see the sea. I'm thinking the sea's going to be the end of the movie.
Yeah, I was too.
And well, imagine both our shock then, listeners, when the sea is the next fucking scene. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, we're here already. And she goes down there. She's jumping around in the water and he's standing up on the beach and she's yelling shit. She
literally takes off her top to go out into the water.
I'm telling you, she got them titties out like a motherfucker in this movie. Mm-hmm. And what's she out there saying, Chris?
Don't you love me?
Yeah, I love you.
Yeah, say it, you love me?
I just did. He's like, I love you. And then she's
till
like,
death do you part?
Like, till death do me part.
Something like that.
Yeah, and it's, she's like, smile super hard. And she like runs full speed up to him and like bombs his ass, hits him right in the motherfucking jaw.
One of like three times.
Yeah, she hits him a lot in this movie. But that time, I was like, oh shit. And then Chris finally wake up and he was like in a barn or something. Mm-hmm. And some dude comes in there and says it. Chris, what does he say?
You've pretty much been drugged.
Nope. He says, Welcome to Whoop Whoop.
Welcome to Whoop Whoop, Mike.
And so from this point of the movie forward, halfway through the notes, and I don't know if it was halfway through the movie or not, but he about to be here the rest of this time. Mm-hmm. Describe Whoop Whoop for the listeners, Chris. How would you describe it?
Basically, the deep south of Australia.
Because it's basically Whoop Whoop is like its own little contained little colony of people ran by a guy named Daddy. And there's some inbreeding going on, folks, because there's only so many people there.
It's like if you emancipated the deep south from America.
Yeah, just like you said, if the deep south had its own little stretch there in Australia, and basically they're living in a crater, because when they finally show a zoom out later, they're in a big ass crater in the ground.
Yeah.
So it's going to be hard for your man to even try and get out of there, because
that crater almost looks familiar. Like, I almost want to look up if there's any facts about that.
Let me hit IMDb and find out for you real quick. No. I didn't mention it is based on a book. I forgot about that.
Yeah, something Heart, wasn't it?
I just saw it too. The Dead Heart. Mm-hmm. Oh, it said that another Australian film had actually been called Dead Heart in 1996, the year before this. That's why they didn't use that title.
That's what Daddy-O's catchphrase was. Fafangula.
What does that mean? Does it say?
No, it doesn't say.
Oh, fuck. Well, I will say this while we're talking about shit like that. The phrase whoop whoop, according to Urban Dictionary, so IMDb knew where to fucking look. It's an Australian term, a collective description for any destination outside your local area, i.e. far away. So basically the middle of fucking nowhere. Or I don't know what they always say, like the bum fuck nowhere type shit. That's whoop whoop in Australian, I guess.
Right.
What else they got on here for trivia? I'm looking at this. Anything else?
I guess it was Chelsea Brown's final film.
Say that again?
It said it was the final film of Chelsea Brown. Who's that on here?
Not sure. Oh, okay. I had a feeling something like this must have happened, because the reason it didn't make any money, Chris, it says, due to big negative audience response to the movie, it went straight to video in a number of territories. So that's probably why it didn't make no money. Which makes sense, because I never heard of this shit, probably.
It played Maud.
Oh, okay. I don't know who she was in the movie, though. I don't recognize none of these fucking people in this movie.
Yeah. Rod Taylor, his name sounds familiar.
He was in the Birds. That's the first thing I remember that dude. Oh, he's in other shit, too.
I haven't seen Birds in years.
I own it. Don't tell me that. We'll watch it one day.
It was like one of those like middle school movies. For some reason, somebody decided to bring that in on like a free day.
Oh, Chris, don't fuck with me. I own The Birds and The Birds 2.
God, was two?
The 90s sequel that went straight to fucking video. Oh, yes. Thank you, Vinegar Syndrome, for that one.
Why was there two of them?
It sucks. There was a little period there where they kept trying to do Hitchcock movies without Hitchcock, and it never really went well because there was also the Psycho remake in 1998, which is hilarious to me.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, watching Vince Vaughn be Norman Bates is hilarious. Maybe one day Chris will do that one.
Well, I guess that's fun because I've only seen pieces of the original Psycho.
We covered it on the podcast, so it's been done already, but it's definitely worth a watch. We've done this, weirdly enough, we did Psycho 1 and 3. We completely skipped 2. You know, me and PJ love 2, but we did Psycho 3 instead. Psycho 3 is actually pretty good, I ain't gonna lie. Psycho 3 is directed by Anthony Perkins and starring Anthony Perkins. It feels, of all those Psycho movies, the third one feels the most of its era, like an 80s slasher movie. Psycho 2 feels like, honestly, if Hitchcock was alive, he might have actually dug Psycho 2. He would not like any of the other sequels after that. But one day, Chris, if you had to, whenever you watch Psycho, man, we'll do Psycho 2. And then you go watch Psycho 3. And then we could do Psycho 4. And then we could do the Psycho remake.
Oh, God.
And then if you want to, you can watch Bates Motel. I also love that TV show. I watched every episode.
I think I've actually sat down and watched an episode of Bates Motel.
It's actually pretty good. Of course, they add a lot more because, you know, you got to add something to that simple ass story. But it's worth a watch. But whoop whoop, is it worth a watch? We're going to find out. Because he wakes up in that barn and apparently he didn't got married and everything because he's tied up to a bed later in the
age. They rooted him like a motherfucker.
Before we even get to the bed, when he wakes up in the barn, I didn't know what was on my man's face for a second because he got a bunch of like whipped cream looking shit on his face, but then on his chin is a substance that looks very much like something. I hope it's not. And he was in there super passed out. I don't know if he sleep with his mouth open or not, but it looked like some of them pigs may have stuck something in there. I'll move past it for you, Chris. Because the next scene is when he wakes up tied up in the bed, and that's when he finds out Angie pulls out a wedding photo book. And she's like, oh, we got married. He's like, man, I ain't been married. She's like, oh, yeah, I got pictures to prove it. And she's scrolling through and all the pictures of him being like held up unconscious by daddy on everybody while they got married. So by whoop whoop standards, he fucking wifed up.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes to meet daddy and he gives the rules. Chris, what are the rules of whoop whoop?
Rule number one is once you hear, you don't get to leave unless daddy said so. Or is that rule number two?
I forget what I know the one rule is he's like nobody ever leaves here unless they have permission, and that permission is never given. And then he does something else.
And when another rule is rule number three is don't be fucking around with your cousins.
Because that actually comes up later because you can tell some of these cats have been fucking around with some cousins because you know what I'm saying. But then after that, like honest to God, like from this point forward, it's kind of hard to even talk about a plot movie. Our plot with this movie is it just random shit? Because like after that, there's a scene.
Literally, chaos ensues.
Pretty much, that's the best way to explain the whole rest of this movie. Because after that, the dad puts on some like tap dance shoes that have like wired. They're wired electrical tap dance shoes, and as he does his tap dance, like sparks are shooting out.
Those would have been funny as hell in Pee-wee's Big Adventure if he was wearing those.
I love that you said that because that first thing I thought when he put them shoes on, I was thinking of your boy Pee-wee on the bar top dancing. I thought the same thing, bro. And what else after that? Oh, later on that day, because there's like most of the people here, they all coupled up, and you see how like they make their money. They make dog food out of kangaroo meat, and they ship it off and sell it to stores. That's how they get money and commerce popping in. Whoop whoop, and the dog food is called woof woof. You get it?
Woof woof.
But one night though, somebody's like, man, fuck this shit. I got to get out of here. And he tries to climb out of the crater. But he gets caught. I don't remember what that fucker's name is. I just know he looked like Taika Waititi to me. I legit had to look up and see if that was him. Until he died and I looked at that, that's what I thought that actor was. But yeah, Daddy-O ends up coming out there and shooting him in his back. And there's a woman. I don't remember that woman's name. I never got this woman's name. I just put her as Bird Girl in my notes. The Bird Girl, his wife in Woop Woop is watching over it. And she looks legit distraught because, one, I mean, that's her husband that just got shot in the back by Daddy-O in super cold blood. And nobody gives a fuck. They're all cheering it on. And so she runs off. She'll be back later, folks. Don't worry about it.
Crystal was her name.
There you go, Chris. I never got that fucking name, bro.
And the dude who got shot was Midget.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm legitimate. It's not Taika Waititi, right?
No.
That's all I can think of. But the next day.
Yeah, he looks familiar, though. I feel like I've seen his face before.
Let's see. Hold on, you said it. Let me see. I'm going to look him up for you real quick. Then see. Knowing from anything. Paul Mercurio. I know that name. Why do I know that name? Because I don't know any of this shit that he's done. I don't know who this is. He's in a Baz Luhrmann movie called Strictly Ballroom. He's in a movie called Exit to Eden, directed by Gary Marshall with motherfucking Rosie O'Donnell and Dan Aykroyd.
He's on Dancing with the Stars? That might be where I recognize
Maybe
it.
I might have heard some, because movie-wise, I don't know. I ain't never seen I mean, I've seen this.
Mm-hmm. Other than that.
Yeah. Yeah, I have no fucking idea what this is. But yeah, that guy, he got smoked, though. He got a short part in this movie. He got pushed in, bro, by that sniper boy.
Pushed in, bro. His back is broken.
That's right.
I broke my back. Spinal.
Got you. And next scene is funny. I did laugh at this, too, because I forget what they called it. They called it, like, Dog Day or what they called it, where the kids are just going around shooting at dogs.
Yeah, it's Dog Day.
Yeah. And I was cracking up because...
Get that 50 mud out of here is what Angie kept telling them.
And this is like the shorthand way for the movie showing you that these people are, like, fucked up or weird or crazy. It's like, oh, my God, they're shooting dogs? Because homeboy Teddy even, like, he steps up to the kid and is like, hey, bro, what the fuck are you doing? Why are you shooting at my dog? And he's like, oh, it's Dog Day, like Chris said. And he's like, I tell you what, motherfucker, shoot me. You a big man, for you a tough guy. Shoot me, motherfucker. And he sticks his index and his middle finger into the barrel of the sawed off. The whole time that this is going on, Crystal, the bird girl, is watching in the background. And she's like, something's going on back there.
He's got some cojones.
Yeah. And she actually kind of tries to flirt with him a little bit, because there's a scene where he's standing there and she got like a fucking buffalo, whatever the hell that was. I don't know what the fuck animal that was, but she looked like she was like, I don't know if she was like trying to do it to impress him, or maybe I thought at first she was going to try and like gift it to him or something, but it runs away. And then she kind of just looks embarrassed like, oh, and he kind of chuckles like, you're so silly. But fuck all that, because now it's Christmas time, but we're not in Hollis, Queens.
And nobody could get no chicken and collard greens.
Make Cameron happy.
But chicken and collard greens.
During the Christmas party, because your boy Teddy, he ain't out there. He's actually out there with the bird girl and a guy named Duffy, a little young dude. And they're playing, I don't know what the fuck is it called? Three Card Monty. There you go. And they're sitting there doing anything. She's betting again. She's trying to, you know, catch his eye, because he's like, they literally are betting marbles, and she literally bets all the marbles. Mm-hmm. He's like, oh, that's a big bet. He's like, well, I'm a big girl. He's like, ooh, okay. But it gets fucked up. The vibe gets ruined immediately, because Daddy-O summons the boy Duffy into the bar where everybody hanging out at. And he don't want to go in there. And Teddy's like, bro, you ain't got to go in there. He's like, I got to go in there. Like, you ain't got to go in there. I got to go in there.
He's like, yeah, I'm going to tell you right now, you don't want to go in there.
But he go in there, because I think his dad comes out there and grabs him. And you come, and your boy Daddy-O is accusing him of fucking his cousin, Chris. The one thing they said you're not supposed to be doing.
He said, what are you supposed to be doing if you get frisky?
Oh.
In a whole bunch of different ways he said it.
He's like, you beat your meat. You throttle your sausage. He said a bunch of them. I was laughing at that, too. Of course. And then he just starts beating the shit out of him. He starts beating him to the ground. And then actually Teddy comes in and is like, hey, yo, basically chill the fuck out, bro. He get it. We understand.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go right back to partying after that. Oh, actually, before we leave the party, though, another big thing happens here. Angie's at the top of the bar area. And she makes the announcement, Chris, that she pregnant.
Anybody but me see because she took a tumble down, I think that it was like a shoot there where when she started coming down, there was a red streak.
Was there?
Wherever she was sliding down that banister or whatever.
Oh, like you think it was blood on there?
I thought so at first.
I didn't even notice that.
And lends credence to stuff later I was thinking the same thing he was.
Oh, hold on. I'm gonna have to come back to that, Dennis. I don't know exactly what you're getting at here, bro. Remember that. We'll come back to it.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to go to the drive-in, folks. It ain't the last drive-in with Joe Bob Briggs. We had a for real drive-in, and they're watching The Fucking Sound of Music. Because
Joe Bob will probably tell these people they need to get a fucking life.
Oh, probably. But then he might like The Sound of Music. I don't know. But I would say now, too, the whole soundtrack for this movie, not the whole, but like 90% of this soundtrack is all Rodgers and Hammerstein music. Because there's like random scenes where everybody in the town is just singing like the King and I shit. It reminds me of fucking Beside the Geek podcast. They're singing the Getting to Know You song. So it's like Stork and Peacock. Are y'all from Whoop Whoop? Is that what's going on here?
Whoop Whoop.
Because they sing that song on their podcast too. So I'm like, the moment I heard it, I don't even think of the King and I think of them motherfuckers. But yeah, they love musicals apparently here in Woo Woo because they're all mouthing the words to the sound of music and everything. But in the corner of his eye, your boy Teddy sees that man Duffy sneaking around. And I'm assuming that he's sneaking to go get some more of that cousin Punani. But on the way, he don't see the cousin fucking. He see that the old dudes, Daddy-O and other two elders, are sitting upstairs in like their little, little bedroom, barroom, whatever it is. And they watching football or whatever sport was on TV. They got beer in the refrigerator. They got a microwave. They heating a wiener schnitzel and shit. And keep in mind, this is supposed to be like no tech, super old school, like village shit. And so they've been holding out on the community. They got a whole room with all this type of bullshit up there. And so they're like, oh, yeah, we're going to tell somebody about this shit right here, bro.
So, yeah, because from context from before, they're holding out because they want to. Like they keep getting diced pineapples for Christmas and
yeah, some, a big ass like Costco can of it.
And I think Mama wanted some Marlboros.
Yeah, that's right. They got cigarettes. That's another big thing I forgot about too. They got cigarettes. They got beer. They got food. They got TV up there, living lavish. And him, I think Duffy sees it too because we're gonna come back to that later. But first, Duffy takes him up in the mountains because he's like, "What the fuck is?" The big red. He's like, oh, it's a kangaroo. And he tells her they got cave or drawings on the wall of a big kangaroo and shit. Again, it comes back later. And the whole time I was wondering, because in their little community, you know, everybody, they canning fucking food or they hunting and killing kangaroos. I was like, what is this motherfucker doing? I'm like, at some point, they're going to probably make you be like, hey, you got to do something here. You got to contribute. They already took all his money and shit. He's like, hey, everything here goes around to the community, which again is a lie, Daddy-O, because he ain't passing around the Marlboros. Hippo Crips. Nah.
Hippo Crips.
But he the whole time, I guess he's been working on fixing the VW because there's a whole scene where he's like showing out like, hey, man, look, I fixed this car. I'm that dude. Y'all hyping shit. And he's like, hey, you know what? Here, I'm going to show y'all some magic tricks, too. And he has the old gag where, you know, you put the woman in the box and you saw it in half. Wifey don't want to do
it. But he was actually smart about it. He actually just went around the box instead of trying to do some, like, some foolery where it's like some. It's all about perception most of the time with that, with magic. You're basically throwing people off to look at something else.
Yeah. This time sleight he kind of hand.
Yeah, sleight of hand. Where this time it just looks like he kind of just cut around it.
Yeah, he obviously like, and I know that I had a feeling that's probably what he was gonna do too, because he kept saying when he was looking for volunteers, he was like, "Hey, do I have any, you know, thin or small young ladies that would like to volunteer?" And his wife don't want to do it because you know she's pregnant, quote unquote. And so Bird Girl Crystal steps up and is like, "Yo, I'm down. Let's get it," because she's trying to get in there any way she can, anyway. So she goes up and volunteers, and like Chris said, she's laying in the middle, and he saws down like halfway, and then he moves forward. He starts cutting it from the front, and he cuts it to the back. Basically, he does like arch. I couldn't think of the fucking word. And then he pulls it apart and everything. Cool. So everybody there is like, oh my God. But then I guess wifey got salty because he was having so much fun with another woman or something. She's crazy as fuck anyway. So she runs out screaming. Yeah, she's fucking insane, bro. Everybody here is insane except for the Bird Girl, pretty much, almost. Well, not everybody, I guess. Unless you think it's crazy that old boy fucking his cousin, then he might be crazy too. But Duffy don't seem that crazy.
Duffy just hungry for some ass, and he couldn't wait.
Yeah. Well, you're like, 18-year-old dude or something like that? Hell yeah. Probably. All right, the next scene, though, you got to tell me what the fuck happened here, Chris, because I legit watched it, and I didn't know what happened at the time even, because... Later on, I think it's not a part. That's a different scene. But Daddy-O is sitting inside the Volkswagen with a dead dog. What the fuck happened?
So, yeah, Daddy-O caught whiff of the fact that his daughter, that Angie was unhappy because she saw that shit. So he, in a drunken stupor, takes the wagon apart, and apparently he also shoots the dog.
Yeah, because he was like, "Oh, it's dog day." And he's like, "Motherfucker, dog day was last week."
He's like, "It wasn't me. It was little Jimmy, something like that."
It was our truth.
He says some little kid that it's dog day. They get all ornery, you know. He's like, "Dog day was last week."
Yeah. I didn't even put it together that it was because of the daughter being upset. I was curious, like, what the fuck happened?
He saw her get upset and walk away.
Yeah. So your boy pissed. Teddy like, man, fuck this dude. So the next day he actually grabs up, Duffy, and gets the town ready. And they go up to Daddy-O and he calls him out. Snitches him out for having the TV and all that up there. And he's like, yo, Duffy was with me. Duffy will tell you. And Duffy's like, I ain't see shit. He's like, oh, he just scared. And he starts going on and on, but then your man's on some Black Dynamite shit. Remember, there's a scene where the little politician's like, yo, watch me flip this shit. And he goes out there and does a speech and turns the whole crowd the opposite way. He does the exact same thing here.
This whole town was basically, well, all of us were given a plot of land that literally was taken off the map. And we called and called to talk to people. Nobody wanted shit to do with us. When we finally got a hold of somebody, they were just going to ship us out somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
And no, we're going to come back and claim this land as ours. And nobody's going to fuck with us. Are you with me, people?
Yeah!
This is our town!
Yeah! Basically, like, hey, look, this is y'all shit. Y'all own this shit. Y'all really want to leave here and go live on somebody else's shit? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I thought, motherfuckers. Go back out there and pay taxes and shit.
Right.
Nobody gives a fuck. The town goes. This is actually the next note. Here's where I realized I was writing this dude's name wrong the whole time. It's where I started. I had to go back in my notes and X out Lionel. I don't know where the fuck Lionel came from.
Mm-hmm.
But they're watching it. I don't know what movie it is this time at the drive-in, but they're back at the drive-in again.
Some kind of 50s musical movie look like.
It's another musical, but this one I do not recognize in the slightest. I'm already not a big fan of musicals, so I don't know. But the Bird Girl was like, she tells him, like, hey, you know, because they've been both falling for each other behind the scenes a little bit in the background. And she finally is like, hey, look, they having a drive-in next week. No, come holler at me. And he does just that. He sneaks away from old girl. And they go in there and they have a little dinner. It looks like they eating the, like, gruel or mashed potatoes. I don't know what the fuck they eating.
Right.
But they starting to get to know each other a little bit, getting to know you, getting to like you, all that King and I bullshit. Mm-hmm. But they get caught, Chris. What happens?
Yeah, Angie was not on that shit. She was mad. And she punched the fuck out of him again.
Knocked him out too. He out the whole rest of that scene, I think.
Yeah, she dragged him outside after that.
Oh, she did drag him. Well, he's still out though. Yeah, she hit him with that Nivea. Don't mess with my man. I'm gonna be the one to bring it to you. Yeah, I just unlocked a memory for somebody. Y'all forgot about that,
right? She's just like basically cussing out her sister, like, don't fuck with my shit.
And speaking of which, you just said that I didn't realize that they were supposed to be sisters until the next scene.
I didn't know that either until she said that.
Yeah, like the next scene is basically the mom, the one that got the chopped up pineapple. She's dying. And because they had a whole plan. He was telling her, like, look, we're going to escape here together. I'm going to get the keys. I'm going to do what I got to do. And we're going to bang. Nah, I mean, we're going to bang, but I mean, bang out, though.
Yeah.
But now that her mom is dying, she tells him, like, look, I can't, my nigga, that's my mama, bruh. I can't leave mama.
Right. But your mama.
But he got the key. And, oh, actually, the mom actually whispers something to him, too, because he's in there talking, and you don't know what she whispered. But whatever it is between Bird Girl being like, I can't leave, and whatever the mom whispered to him, he kind of, you know, he got that look. He's like, fuck, I can't leave.
He's like, you got a future here.
Yeah. Basically. Well, what they say at the end, what she whispered to him was, and I'll spoil it now, fuck it, that Angie ain't really pregnant. That's what the whisper was.
Mm-hmm.
It's because he tells Bird Girl that in the car when they finally get away. So the mom is basically like, hey, look, get the fuck out of here. So, but he hesitates because he really wants to take old girl with him too. So he ends up actually leaving it with her because there's a scene where she goes back to the room or her house or whatever. And the keys are sitting there on the mantle. And that's a symbol like, hey, look, we going together. So whenever you ready, we going to roll. And they're having a funeral for the moms. And they're just burning her on a fucking pyre. It reminded me of fucking Candyman is what it looked like. You ever seen Candyman, yeah. Chris?
Yeah, I've seen pieces of it.
Damn it, Chris.
Pieces into pieces, I know. But that's more like a, that's like a Viking funeral going on there, too.
Yeah, that's true. I was going to say that shit probably stink, but it probably already stink out there. I can only imagine what that shit smells like.
Basically, now at, it turned from burning trash to burning trash and
flesh. And shit. Burning trash, burning shit, burning flesh, stanking out there. Mm-hmm. But while everybody's watching the funeral pyre, though, Teddy and, well, I think Girlie actually escapes. The Bird Girl's eyes. She's like climbing up and she's,
yeah, she already fucked off after in the middle of the ceremony.
Yeah, because once she got to see her mom one last time and they threw her down, she just made her way up there. Oh boy, it took a little bit too long though, because he get caught again by Angie. Yeah.
Angie's talking to him about like, Reggie said it might be twins.
Yeah.
You know, you want to name them.
And he says Sonny and Cher. I did kind of laugh at that.
He's just like, oh, you're a naughty girl. You deserve to be tied up and spanked.
Mm-hmm.
So he just ties her up and bangs out.
Mm-hmm. He spanks up out of there. He's starting to escape because they're going to go into, they got like a big garbage truck thing that they're going to try and escape in. I guess that's what they were using to ship out their dog food or something, maybe. I don't know.
It's like a dump truck or something.
Yeah. But they don't get far because Daddy-O finds out about it because she gets out of her binding and she just starts screaming her ass off. And the dad runs over there to see what's going on with her. And they jump into that Volkswagen and the chase is on, Chris. And you get a whole
new... First they give it a facelift, basically.
Yeah, he drove it out of the garage without the garage door being all the way open. Basically took the whole top off except for the windshield. Mm-hmm.
Made it a convertible.
Mm-hmm. A drop top Scooby-Doo. But they go drive out there. It's actually the sequence they do right here is actually pretty cool. A little action scene. You know, you got homeboy hanging off the top of the car and hanging off of the door and they shooting at him and shit. It's actually kind of well filmed, I won't lie.
Yeah.
But Chris, we've been talking about this goddamn kangaroo. It's about time for it to finally show up. Chris, tell me about Big Red.
Oh, yeah. The Big Red kangaroo, I guess, comes out of fucking nowhere and grabs the bug and
it rushes toward it. It's like huge too.
And it out of nowhere, they're just like, are they okay?
I thought, look, I swear to God, I thought they were dead. There was a quick shot.
So did Bird Girl too. But then they drop out of nowhere.
Yeah, they just basically, it looked like the kangaroo just took the tires off of the cars. It looked like all the tires were gone and they were, old boy was like super fucked up. He was like trying to drink a beer and it was splashing everywhere. But there was a shot where they show like the collision, I guess, with the Big Red. And it must have just been some dummies in there because I'm like, the way they was moving around, I'm like, oh, they're dead. But then,
But they stop for a second to check, but they start bucking again.
That's right. Yo, Girlie start bucking. Like, so homeboy in there kind of woozy in there. She gets out and starts shooting and then she starts crying because he gone.
He gone.
He gone. They escaped. Him and Bird Girl got up out of there. And then... there's like one final shot of them driving through the desert or whatever. And you see that dude from the beginning that he dropped off with the $20 playing. I think was it the didgeridoo plan or some shit. Mm-hmm. And he sees him from real far away. He got some good ass eyes and he waves. And your boy Teddy waves back at him, lays his head on old girl's shoulder. And she lays her head on his head. And they drive off together. And that is Welcome to Whoop Whoop.
Well, you didn't see the post credits, did you?
Oh shit, there's a post credits? Legitimately, the moment this movie ended, I stopped it.
Yeah, there was post credits. I did my due diligence and fast forwarded and looked.
Oh, what's going on?
So we cut to 15 years later and they have a bird shop at this point.
Oh.
You got two kids walking to the shop 15 years later, a boy and a girl.
Oh.
And she calls the dude out and he's just like, meet Sonny and Cher.
Oh shit. Who calls him?
Good night, Dad.
Angie was there?
No, Angie wasn't there. It was the
the girl calls him out.
Yeah.
Oh, so she actually was pregnant.
Apparently, and that's why I'm like, I was thinking the same damn thing. Like, she's doing all this heavy drinking and shit, and she's pregnant.
I legit thought it was she was lying. So now that begs the question. Was he lying when he told Girlie that the mom said she wasn't pregnant? Or what, did the mom bullshit him to get him out of there? Nah, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
I didn't catch the part where she whispered in his ear something.
You couldn't hear it, but there's a part where she was, because she's when they're driving away, because she's driving the car and shit, and she says like, "I feel so bad, you know, she's pregnant, she's my sister," and she's like, "Don't worry, your mom told me she wasn't really pregnant," or something like that.
No, I thought she just said, "Did she tell your mom?"
Maybe I misheard it then. I could have sworn he said that. But fuck it. Yeah, I guess she was then. Eh. I'm just looking up on Wikipedia. It doesn't even mention the post-credit scene in the plot description either. So fuck.
And the trivia mentions that the kids who played Sonny and Cher, they weren't added to the credits, I don't think, at the end.
Oh, okay.
But they showed up, but they weren't. I don't think they were on the credits.
Huh. Trying to see him looking through the notes. There was something I was going to read on the notes. Oh, it says, yeah, this is right. This is one of the few times in movies when an actor or actress makes their first appearance in the movie after their name is listed in the end credits. And they said, yes, there's a scene after the credits were done, which takes place 15 years later. I completely missed that. There's a book titled Fafangula, The Despised and Indispensable Welcome to Whoop Whoop. In an interview, Julie Andrews stated how she had consent rights over the use of her image in The Sound of Music. So this movie was screened for her, and she was allegedly a bit hesitant, but in the end, she just said, okay, go use it. She's like, hey, fuck it. How much y'all paying me for? Oh, here you go, Chris. It says Stephen Elliott, as it was, what is it? Oh, he appears uncredited as a truck driver. I wonder if he was a truck driver that said the little sausage line that you were talking about. All right, well, that was Welcome to Whoop Whoop. Pretty quick, because, like I said, there's really no real plot. And comedy movies, again, are, you know, just jokes.
Just jokes.
So we're going to play promo. Then we're going to come back and tell you what we thought about Welcome to Whoop Whoop. Don't go nowhere.
This is Murderous Minors, Killer Kids, bringing you the frightening and truly insane tales of children with the thirst to kill. Kindergarten through 12th grade murderers. True stories thoroughly researched. Join us weekly for new tales of parents' worst nightmares on Murderous Minors, Killer Kids.
I gotta go through that show's archive and find out the episode of War Baby is talking about a killer kindergartner.
Killer kindergartners.
I gotta go see that shit. Well, Chris.
Yeah.
Just me and you, so you get to go first. What did you think about Welcome to Whoop Whoop?
Honestly, I just thought it was harmless.
Okay.
It was there. Like,
yeah.
There were times when I chuckled and, you know, this shit was nonsensical as hell. If it was like a Sunday morning and I could just like, if it's on TV and I probably fall asleep to or something, take a nap to or something.
This was watched on a Sunday morning for us both, Christopher. Oh, an afternoon for you, I guess. I forgot it's later over there, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wouldn't mind it playing in the background on either doing something or falling asleep.
Did you have a favorite part of the movie? Anything stand out to you? Any memorable parts?
Not much, just like randomly out of nowhere, the stripper at the beginning, like shooting the dudes.
That whole opening sequence is the best part of this whole movie.
It's the best, yeah.
That was the best. For like no reason,
and then all of New York's got a strap on them for to try to shoot these birds for no reason.
They Spice One out here in these streets, rolling with the motherfucking strap on the side of me.
On that note, I give it a 6, probably.
6 is way higher than I thought you were gonna give it.
it's slightly above average just because of that beginning.
Okay. I'm not going to be as nice, my brother. Because, again, I was hesitant to watch it because I'm just like, man, this look like something I ain't going to like, bro. Like, I don't know. But that opening sequence actually pepped me up a little bit when I saw, like, her shooting the dude and, like, all the people on the street, even the kids pulling out guns and shooting at birds and the goofy tone with him being in disguise and ripping the mustache off. Like, all right, this might be all right. Mm-hmm. I was like, you know, you have my attention now. And honestly, even the opening parts when he first gets to Australia and him like getting smashed up by old girl and the shower gas sticks at the gas station, I didn't mention, but like the dude is blind. He's trying to pump gas. So he just keeps nudging the thing into the side of the car until he finally finds the gas hole and shit. Like, I did laugh at that too.
Yeah, I kind of laughed at that too.
And even in that stuff, when he pretty much, honestly, I hate to say when he gets to whoop whoop, that's when the movie kind of drags. Like when he gets to right. the title location. And I will say,
I feel like whoop whoop probably was had to be, the stuff with whoop whoop had to be longer for cans. Maybe. And that's probably why they got a bad reception.
Maybe that's why it was, I keep saying either 146 or 137. Maybe it was 146 originally. I don't know, but yeah, I don't know. A lot of that stuff was just like, you know, you chuckle. It's some sensible, as PJ would say, the sensible chuckles here and there. Mm-hmm. It did not go the way I thought it would. Again, like I thought it was going to be a big road trip movie and something like that would happen. I didn't expect him to fall in love with one of the whoop whoopians, even though she was the only other, like, quote unquote, normal person there, as he even calls out in the movie, which I wondered right. at first. I was like, well, she's somebody else that got kidnapped, but then she was old girl's sister. So I'm like, oh, I guess she just didn't come up as weird as everybody else. And then they had the decent little action scene again, like with him hanging on the door of the car, the truck, and on the front of it, and the guns, bullets, blood ricocheting off everything. Like, it had little moments here and there, but honestly, for the most part, man, I was nodding. I was in and out of the movie. It was, like, driven. Like I mean, Chris said, you know, if you're tired, man, you might need to throw this on. It might be all right. But I did like the way it was, like, the shot and the location and everything. Like, it felt like they filmed in a little community. You know what it felt like, Chris? It felt yeah. like Bedrock from the Flintstones movie.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, that location looked familiar. I thought it may be Ayers Rock or something like that.
It could be. I didn't see anything in the trivia. But it reminded me of that, the John Goodman Flintstones movie, a movie we may have to do on this podcast. I remember loving that as a kid, and I have not seen it since then. Might have to revisit that. I don't know if we're going to do Viva Rock Vegas or none of that shit, but we could definitely watch that first one at some point.
Yeah, that first one was genuine, and it was just all right. I don't remember a lot of the first one. The second one, I really don't remember because I remember it being ass.
I never seen anything past the first. I never saw that sequel. I've never even really seen the cartoon a whole lot. I would watch the cartoon back in the day when it would play on TV because, you know, we only had so many channels, but I never really, honestly, as controversial as that may sound, I liked the movie better than the cartoon growing up. So, hey,
honestly,
I'm a kid of the
90s. Yeah,
too.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Because, like, the TV show itself was like one of those slice of life type of TV shows.
Yeah, it's weird. They don't really do it, at least not, I can't think of enough time I had to do that. Because, well, I guess The Simpsons counts in a way. But it was like animated, just straight like sitcoms. Like if this was normal people, we could still play the same way. Not like Family Guy where they do like our South Park, they're doing outrageous shit. Like The Flintstones was legit just a sitcom, just happened to be animated. Like,
yeah, that was literally The Flintstones. I think to an extent, The Jetsons too.
Yeah, that, even more so, yeah, The Jetsons.
I remember being bored watching The Jetsons.
I never liked The Jetsons. I never could get into The Jetsons, bro.
I tried to watch one episode and I was bored.
Yeah, same here. You know, it was, again, it might be a chuckle here and there. I will say between the two, I would rather watch The Flintstones for sure while I eat my Fruity Pebbles, motherfucker. But
right.
It's a better cereal.
Get you a Winston cigarette while you at it.
That's right.
I get that deep cut in there.
Back when the doctors tell you smoking is good for you. Yeah,
a cigarette a day will keep the doctors away.
No, legit, what Chris is talking about, there's an actual, like, they were selling fucking cigarettes and that. Again, proving my point that it wasn't just a cartoon for kids. It was a fucking show, right?
Mm-hmm. Basically, if y'all curious, look up Flintstones Winston cigarette commercials.
You know what? Don't even worry about looking it up, folks. Just keep listening. Well, if you want to see it, you might want to look it up. But, you know, I'm going to play the audio for you real quick.
They sure work hard, don't they, Barney?
Yeah. I hate to see them work so hard.
Yeah, me too.
Talking about their wives. Yeah,
let's go around back
where we can't see them.
Gee, we ought to do something, Fred.
Okay. How's about taking a nap?
I got a better idea. Let's take a Winston break.
That's it. Winston is the one filter cigarette that delivers flavor 20 times a pack. Winston's got that filter blend.
Yeah, Fred. Filter blend makes the big taste difference, and only Winston has it up front where it counts. Here, ahead of the pure white filter, Winston packs rich tobaccos specially selected and specially processed for good flavor.
Sell.
Yeah, Barney, Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
There you go, folks.
The Flintstone.
You smoking yet?
the first comment, somebody said, I hate to see them work so hard. Yeah, me too. Let's go around back with like crying emojis. That was,
that was fucking gold right there.
Maybe I need to rewatch the Flintstones cartoon too.
I mean, Fred was kind of a fucking asshole.
That's why it might be funny, actually. I legitimately haven't seen the Flintstones cartoon or movie since I
was that working man, but he was still kind of an asshole.
Yeah, well, you know, every working man's a little bit of an asshole, I would say. I'm sure people mm-hmm. agree. But yeah, welcome to Woo Woo, though. I can appreciate the filmmaking, like I said, the location. The acting is actually not bad. I just can't understand half the shit they're saying. I wonder how Australian people feel about this movie. Australian listeners, tell me how you feel about this. Have you seen it? Hell, have y'all even seen this shit? I don't know. Mm-hmm. Do y'all call shit whoop whoop still in 2024? Or is this a 1997 thing? Is it antiquated? I don't know. But for the movie itself, admittedly, I'll go ahead and say I will never watch this again. Like, it's one and done. I was forced to do it. I don't think I'd watch this again. I don't think I'd buy it. I'd give it a 4 out of 10. I don't think I'd want to watch this again. I'll watch that opening scene again.
Yeah.
But as far as the movie go, yeah, I think that's the same score I gave Wild Side too. I can legitimately say I enjoyed this about the same as Wild Side.
I mean, I actually see. I feel like I got a few more sensible chuckles than you out of this.
You did just from explaining the movie. Yeah, it was like I said, a lot of movie. I was like drifting. I was fighting the urge to start scrolling on my phone. I was like, no, watch the fucking movie. It's for the podcast.
At first, I was too. Then I started getting into it a little bit. Yeah, there was like some sensible chuckles here and there.
I got into it a little bit more when the Bird Girl plot started going through because I was curious how that was going to play out with him basically going from one sister to the other and both sisters being the daughters of the evil leader of the town. So it did have
basically over here slinging dick left and right.
Mm-hmm. One sister act up. If your girl starts acting up, then you take her friend. But her sister's even worse. Shout out to Sugar Hill Gang. But yeah, 4 out of 10. I was debating between a 4 and a 5, but I was like, no, nah, just give it a 4 because 5 don't feel right. Got to go with the hustle dump apparently on this one. So there it is. But Chris, now that we we have exited Whoop Whoop, I'm going to give him some Black History flashcards from the urban intellectuals. And today I'm going to tell y'all about, oh man, I'm sorry, Maria in advance. Maria Arotia. She's born March 25th, 1965, and she's still around, folks. She's from Colombia, and she's a former Olympic weightlifter and politician and a track and field athlete. She completed the shot put and discus throw from the early 1980s. She went on to compete in the 1988 Olympics. In 1989, she became a weightlifter and would go on to win gold in the 1990 and 1994 World Championships, silver in 91, 95, and 97, and then bronze in 96 and 98. I guess she was getting older. She's like, I'm too old for this shit now. But she still got bronze, though. You still in the top 3, motherfucker.
Yeah.
During the 2000 Summer Olympics, she won her country's first gold medal in the women's 75-kilogram class, or KG class. I don't know what the fuck. after the Olympics, she started her political career and was elected to the Chamber of Representatives of Colombia in 2002 and 2006. And she's also an advocate for social justice for women of African descent. Maria Rutia. Shout out to you. Christopher.
Yo.
We only got 2 Patreon picks left, man. We almost there.
And almost to the end.
I was thinking about it too. This works out perfectly because May 11th, whatever week that falls on, it's a celebration, man. 8-year anniversary is coming up.
It's our anniversary.
Damn right. Because May 11th is, as I called it back in the day, I don't know if I still have it after I moved, but I had my original paper. It wasn't even paper. It was actually an envelope. It was an envelope from my bank when I opened up an account there. I just had the envelope on hand. And that's where I wrote down the original stats for the podcast, like all the different names. And then the day that we were going to start everything and all that. And it's May 11th. I put on there big capital letters, Hustle Day.
Hustle Day.
And it's going to be our Hustle Day holiday next month. 8 motherfucking years, man. It's crazy. But before that, we got 2 more Patreon picks to go. And I'm going to keep it honest with you. Again, I really don't feel like watching Robin Hood. So what we're going to watch next week is Nicole's Patreon pick. It's a movie called Romeo is Bleeding. Ever heard of this? Nicole actually like gave me a copy of the DVD, like, here, motherfucker, watch it. So I ain't even gotta go seek it out. But for Chris, let's see if it's streaming. I'm pretty sure I saw it was on Pluto.
Yeah, I think so.
It's from 1993, and it is currently streaming on it's on Tubi and Pluto. So you got your. I would honestly, if I was you, I'd go to Tubi. They got less commercials, but. And Chris, let's go ahead and give him a little bit of a taste of it. Romeo Is Bleeding is an hour and 40 minutes long. It says the story of a cop who wanted it bad and got it worse. A corrupt cop gets in over his head when he tries to assassinate a beautiful Russian hit woman. And Chris, guess who the star of this movie is?
Gary Oldman.
Gary motherfucking Oldman.
A spider from Lost in Space.
There you go. Oh, now that's a movie. To watch one day. I haven't seen that since we saw it in the theater back in 1997.
Yeah, me either, I don't think.
Because I know you were there with me. I don't know. I think it was all four of us. I think it was me, you, Cameron, and Andrew. I think we all went. But yeah.
Yeah, and I didn't know how to feel after that. I think it broke my little brain when I was trying to figure out what was going on.
It's been so long that I don't even remember if I liked it or not.
Same.
Because I remember it would play on TV. I think it was, I don't know if it was TNT or TBS. One of them motherfuckers used to play it constantly. And I would watch it sometime, but I've never owned it. I've never watched it in full again since that day.
Mm-hmm.
So that might be something to go back to one day. I mean, hey, patrons, I mean, if you want to.
Just do a whole like Star Trek knockoff or space themed month.
Oh, don't just say less. You already know that's my genre anyway. Just do bootleg sci-fi month. As you know, the crazy thing, I thought it bombed in the theaters. It actually didn't. It came out in 1998. It cost $80 and it made $136.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think it made money. I thought it just got.
It had names. It had Gary Oldman, Matt LeBlanc.
Yeah, Gary Oldman, William Hurt, Heather Graham.
Yeah, William Hurt and Heather Graham.
Who else in there? Lacey Chabert, Jared Harris. I know all these. Mimi Rogers. I know all these people.
Mm-hmm. It had star power.
Yeah, good old New Line Cinema. It had the connection to TV show. So if people knew the TV show, they probably went to go see. I've never seen the TV show before.
There's also Galaxy Quest.
Now, Galaxy Quest, I watched a lot. I didn't see that in the theater, but I had that tape, though, back when I was a kid. That was a good one.
I haven't seen that in ages.
Yeah, I haven't seen it since the early 2000s.
Yeah, same.
But yeah, this Romeo Is Bleeding, though. That's what we got coming up next. And that is Patreon pick. That will be Patreon pick 54 from Nicole of the Superiority Complex podcast. And then after that, we got one more. And then after that, y'all are back to doing what I want y'all to watch. And we'll also get the next Patreon picks, too. So, but until then, Chris, you should give them some of that good old info in case they want to find you online.
Okay. You can find me on X. At crisscross 0018. You can find me on Facebook at Chris Smith. And you can find me on Instagram and Threads at csmith0018. I'm out there.
I had to do it just so people could hear what we be referencing. I don't know if I've ever actually played it so people know what the fuck we be talking about. I come around, stay on top, but remain from the underground. To the state, and we all in the family. Rearrange the whole game with my brother sound. Don't even say your own name when I come around. Stay on top, but remain from the underground. That was in round two?
I could have sworn that was round two.
I can't. You know, legitimately, the only song I remember from fucking Fight Night Round 2 is that damn Fabulous song because it played like every like other song.
I feel like it rotated between that and that Fabulous song.
It was a tit for tat, tit for tat. Doom, 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 doom. Let me look up Fight Night Round 2. Do you know, you talk about something I miss from back in the day. Man, I miss Fight Night. I mean, I still own it. I can play it, but it's like I wish the sequels never was as good as that first one, man.
Just breaking people's faces.
Man, I used to like kill motherfuckers in that game, bro. It was over.
It's just literally nothing but haymaker, haymaker, haymaker.
Yeah, oh yeah, because no, I was my thumbs back in the day. Because that's the thing, I had it on the GameCube. You know, the GameCube had the C stick as the right thumbstick, and so that little man, I would clack, 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 clack. I could knock that shit left and right so fast, bro. I would flash knock out the
computer. I got big thumbs. It was so small for me. I was struggling until I started playing it on PlayStation. Then I started actually trying. Pretending to, well, getting the actual box and like actually blocking and then hit haymaker.
Well, yeah, no, I hardly ever blocked. I didn't need to. I'm like, your ass is opened up, homie. Because I had a dude I created on there. His name was The Punisher. And like legitimately, I was undefeated. Because I had plugged a GameCube in years later. And I went on there and my dude was under. It was like 0 and fucking like 85 or some crazy fucking number.
Did you retire him or is he still on there?
If I plug it in, he probably still on there. I don't think I ever did. Because I would just go back to it randomly and just beat the fuck out of like Roy Jones or somebody. Winky Wright get knocked the fuck out. Shout out to Winky Wright, man. But this is a song we used to talk about right here, though. That's the song that would always come on at the main menu when you first turned it on, too.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot this was on there. Yes, yes, yo. That's when my dude walked out, too. He had the Ghetto Boys. But no, this is the other song. It was Tit for Tat and this are the two I remember the most. Échenle no chile. Échenle no chile. Yeah. Those are the two songs that always played the most.
That song come on anytime I ever do the training.
Yes. I remember this too. This played during the little opening movie right here. I think so.
Yeah, that was like that the opening to the movie. Yeah.
This always played after the training. After you, when you getting the stats on the screen.
Mm-hmm. Boom,
hold ya. Yeah. You out there in that cotton? No, sir. I'm in the back. That's when you picking your fights and shit. Oh, man, it's bringing back memories like a motherfucker.
Man.
Think about this one. Hit City, motherfucker. That would play after the fights a lot of times. I remember that. I think that's the song Andrew used to have when he walked out. Man, good times, bro. When the fuck did Fight Night Round 2 come out? Because, man, that's about to make me feel old as hell when I look up this date.
Man, we need a backwards compatible PS5 version.
EA. Or just make a fucking better one.
NCAA. Bring this back.
Man, that one came out in North America. It came out March 1st, 2005.
God damn.
That shit about to be 20 years ago, Chris.
God damn.
Fucking old, man. Yeah, no. Nah,
y'all was bold enough to bring back NCAA. Bring Fight Night back.
Yeah, because, I mean, I didn't like... Because that's the thing. Fight Night Round 2, or Fight Night Round 3, it did the thing that I despised with the wrestling games for so long. It made it, like, too realistic.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's like you...
And then they went in the champion, which we just did the same. Champion. It did it even worse.
It was about to say, I actually did like Champion slightly more than 3. I don't even think I ever played 4. There was a round 4. I don't think I ever even played it.
I don't think I played 4.
But, because I think 4 the cover had Tyson and Ali on the front of it, I think.
Mm.
But Champion I did play, and it had the story mode and all that. But it wasn't as bad as it was with the other one, but it was still too much. Like, because like Chris was saying, like I would just be like, clack, 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 clack. And you still had the stamina meter.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't seem like it went down nowhere near as quicker. Because Fight Night Round 3, we all joke about it to this day. But like you would throw a couple punches and all of a sudden your dude just throw a punch. He's like, hey. Like
but
barely throwing
Fight
punches.
Night Champion, the fact that you literally start out with your created character fighting out of the pen.
Mm-hmm. That was hype. Yeah, I love that. That game was actually pretty fun. I played that one for a while, but it still wasn't as good as Part 2. But yeah, 3 was just like... Mm-hmm. Massive disappointment after we played the fuck out of Part 2 so much, or Round 2 so much.
Right.
But man, yeah, bring it back. Do a Champion 2 or just do Fight Night Round 5. I don't give a fuck. But yeah, like you said, they got, you know, the UFC games, they have those and that. Man, I got 2 of those. I bought 4 and it's cool, but it still ain't, because that one you can do kicks and all the other shit, it's like more complicated. I'm like, just give me a good boxing game, damn it.
Yeah, just give me a good boxing game. I don't want all the extra shit.
Yeah, I don't worry about having to do takedowns and kicks, and I want to just punch niggas in the face.
That made me mad playing UFC, trying to worry about doing takedowns and shit.
It's just like NBA, like I try to play, I guess maybe I'm just not good. I don't know, but like when I tried to play, it was way back. I tried to play NBA 2K13. That's how long ago, that's how long it's been since I played a basketball game. And I just,
playing NBA Street was just, it was like a sweet science, literally.
Man, NBA Street I go back to is NBA Jam. That's my shit.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm old, but because I love NBA Jam. But 2K13, I remember when I downloaded, it was free on PlayStation Plus, and I had it at that time. And they had the picture that came up with the diagram of the PS4 controller, or 3 controller, PS3 controller. And it had every button did something different. I'm like, I don't like this already.
Like, fuck that.
when you play, I was gonna say NBA Jam, but even when you play fucking NBA Street, shoot, pass, block, or jack or whatever, they steal the ball or something, and then turbo right. button, like run fast. That's all you fucking need. I don't need all that extra.
I feel the same way about the Dragon Ball Z games. Like Dragon Ball Z, when back when they, after the last Budokai Tenkaichi was like, it was like four or something, mm-hmm. and they decided to try to do one of like stuff like Infinite World, where you got they changed up the button controls and like added a whole bunch of extra shit to it.
Yeah, the last just one like, I played Budokai 1. That's the last one I played.
Tenkaichi, like once you get the combos down, like with 1 and 2, mm-hmm. it's a wrap. You just go in, and it's the combos are simple to get down. Like and flying, it's like nothing. But and then they're talking about trying to bring back the same format for Tenkaichi. Mm-hmm. I hope they stick to it and just give us the same simple button controls back in the day.
How is Kakarot? I've been debating about maybe playing.
I've not played
that.
Kakarot.
Okay. It's always on sale, and I'll be looking at it. But now,
I hear something every once so often about Kakarot, but not really, not much.
You ever played what is it called? Is it Xenoverse or whatever the fuck it is? Dragon Ball.
I got Xenoverse 2 on my Switch.
Oh, and do you like it?
Every so often, when I feel like pulling out a Dragon Ball Z game, I pull out Xenoverse.
Oh, okay, so it must be all right then.
And you can get on there and just grind whatever you want to too, because like there's ways you could it adds in the new shit from Super in there too. Like they update it every couple months.
Oh shit, you talking about Budokai? You ever played the Fighters, the Dragon Ball Fighters game? I heard people love
it. Yeah, it went too much into like Tekken territory. I think
I love Tekken,
like Tekken or Street Fighter territory.
Oh okay, I mean. I've never been a big Street Fighter. Over the big three, like, my favorite is Mortal Kombat. 2 is Tekken. Street Fighter is number 3 for me.
Because they got, like, the back buttons doing, the running, like, the walking and shit. So I think it's more like Street Fighter.
Oh, okay. Nah, I mean, that's not necessarily a bad thing. But, yeah, if you're used to the old style, I can see why that would be annoying, though. Maybe I'll check it out one day. I like beating somebody's ass right now and again. But, I didn't even get my... I was about to end the show. I ain't tell everybody where they can find the show at. You can find the Home Video Hustle Podcast on pretty much every social media platform. But mm-hmm. for the sake of tradition, you can find us over on Twitter, a.k.a. X.
X.
At capital H, capital V, capital H, capital P, lowercase I-cast, HVH Podcast on Twitter /X. And X. We're Home Video Hustle on YouTube, Home Video Hustle Podcast on Instagram, Home Video Hustle Podcast on Threads, Home Video Hustle on Blue Sky, Home Video Hustle on, I think, is that what am I missing? Threads? Oh, TikTok, Home Video Hustle on TikTok. And if you want to help support the show like Awful Hero did this week and get us to watch a movie, not Welcome to Whoop Whoop, because now that's done. You can do so over at patreon.com/homevideohustle. We got 2 tiers, really 3, but we got 2 tiers, $1 tier, $3 tier, whatever the fuck you want to give us tier. And with those tiers, you get bonus episodes when we got some for you. Full video recordings of the podcast, nicely looking and sounding now through StreamYard. You can see me and Chris, all the unedited stuff because I don't edit the videos. And of course, you can make us watch movies. Mm-hmm. $1 tier, you get to do it once, one and done. $3 tier, you stay in that cycle. So for example, I was just saying we got 2 movies left. When I go back to get the next batch of Patreon picks, all those $1 people, you're done now. $3 people, I'm going to be messaging you. And you're going to have to give me your movie. We do have some people that never gave me a movie even for this batch. So next batch, I'm going to reach out again. You got to give me a movie. I appreciate your support, but I want to help you out. Help me help you.
Help me help you.
Yeah, tell me what you want me to do. Bars. And that's what we're going to do. But like I said, next week, Romeo is going to be bleeding and we will find out why. Because I know absolutely nothing about this movie. Never had heard of it until Nicole gave it to me. And then after that, we're going to do Robin Hood. But fuck all that, because first we're going to do this Romeo shit. So until next time, I just got one thing left to tell everybody. I'm Brent.
Chris.
Let's get it. There it is. Have a good rest of your Friday. Have a good rest of whatever the fuck day you listen to this on. Unfortunately, this movie is not streaming anywhere. It was on Tubi for a long time. Of course, when we finally went to do it, now it ain't there no more. And it sucks because Chris reached out to me because I just pulled it up on the Fire Stick. Like, you ain't make it available nowhere else, so fuck you. I'm going to get it where I can. But Chris actually, so I didn't even realize there's a trial to what app was it?
It was Stream Picks on Roku, I think, or something like that.
Oh, okay. Yeah, make sure you cancel that account before they charge your ass for it.
Right.
But he had to do that. But then when he said that, I'm like, man, that movie got to be somewhere. And I typed it in on YouTube before and I only got the trailer, but I scrolled down a little bit more and this whole movie is in fact on fucking YouTube. So if you do want to watch it, it's there. And if you want to watch the movie for next week, it's on Tubi and Pluto, so you can catch up and see what we got going on. But until next time, peace.
Peace.